And welcome to church. We invite you all to stand and worship with us. We're so excited you guys are here. Come on and bless the Lord with us today.
Lord, we enter in today expectant for you to move today, for you to bring breakthrough. The things that are holding us back, holding us down, Lord, we ask for you to remove those things, whether spiritual or physical. Lord, may we enter in with confidence, knowing that you're at work in us, that you're at work in this place. Help us to be more aware of your presence today. Lord, as we sing, we ask and pray for revival to take place in this room, in our hearts, in this community, in the world. Let us know that revival is not just a song that we sing. It's not just a moment or a service. It's about repentance. That's what you call us to today. That's what you desire, and that's what we desire, that we would step in, that we would turn away from the things of this world and set our eyes and our focus on you. Because it's in you that we have hope. It's in you we have life. In you we have power. You are what we need. You are what this world needs. And we ask for you to move today. We invite you in. We invite in the expectation and the anticipation that we can become more aware of you today. We sing in faith.
Come on. Oh my.
on my life, you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am made, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Amen. Y'all can have a seat. Good morning and welcome to Low Country Community Church. Aren't you glad and blessed and ever mindful of the fact that in the midst of the craziness of our world, we can come right here today in freedom to proclaim just that, that we serve a good and a wonderful and a gracious God. My name's Jim, one of the many volunteers here at Low Country, and we just want to give a special welcome to you this morning, whether you're joining us here in the room or whether you're joining us online. We have a passion for getting people connected to Christ and then connected to resources to help you grow. So whether you are joining us here each week or whether you're joining us in our online experience, we want to give you opportunities throughout the week to meet you in your specific season of life. In other words, we want you to be known, and we want you to grow with those that know you. If you go to lowcountrycc.org, to our events tab, you'll be able to see a whole array of opportunities. And one big section of that we really want to get you guys connected to are our core classes. And those core classes are specifically designed with you in mind for those various seasons of life, to help you learn more about the church, to help you learn more about growing in your relationship and learning to reach and serve those around you. So please make sure you check that out. And while you're there, check out a lot of different events for lots of different age groups, from children all the way up to our senior ministry, which has a special event starting this Wednesday that's getting going again for them. So make sure that you check that out. But today, we have a really cool opportunity, and I will say the phrase, if you know, you know, when I say these two words, Marquis Laughlin. Marquis Laughlin is, yes, you can give him a precursory round of applause there. He is a special, wonderful, dare I say, anointed pastor and friend of Low Country, and he has been joining us and blessing us for years with his wonderful, inspired presentation of the gospel. And he does that with a specific heart to connect people to the word, to see it come to life, and also to bring the word to underserved and impoverished communities all around the world. He and his wife just sent off two teenagers to college this week, so my mama's heart resonates with his daddy's heart, and they are also raising a teenage son in the light and the love of the Lord, and we are happy to have him with us this morning. As we move into our time of giving, we want to pray over our gifts and our tithes and our offerings and remind you that there's always lots of different ways to get you connected there and help you to feel comfortable in knowing that your gifts matter and they are being used for the kingdom. But as we pray together this morning, we would be remiss if we did not take a special note, a special time, just to pause in our time together today and remember our brothers and sisters in Afghanistan. It's been a hard week for so many different reasons, and as we read about things and we see things that are posted online, one of the prayers that has continued to come across my vision has been praying for supernatural intervention. And I believe, we believe in a God that can do just that for our brothers and sisters in Afghanistan. So let's have a special time of prayer for them as we continue in worship today. Heavenly Father, we know you. We believe in you. We know that you are good. We know that you are good and you are faithful and you are true and you are ever changing, even in the midst of an unchanging world. And we cling to that. We hold on to the promise and the assurance of that. And even when we can't see it, we know that it's there and we know that it's true. And so as we continue to spend time together today, be in our time, but be with those that are seeking you, that are in fear of safety and security, and comfort them in ways that only you can. It's your precious holy name we pray and thank you. Amen. Please welcome Marquis Laughlin.
In my former book, The Gospel According to Luke, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day when he was taken up, after he had given instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. Now to them he presented himself alive after his suffering by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. And while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the gift of the Father, which he said, "You heard from me, for John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now." So when they had come together, they asked him, "Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." And when he had said this, as they were looking on, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. And as they stood there gazing into heaven as he went, behold, two men stood by them dressed in white robes. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand here gazing into heaven? This Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will come in the same ways you saw him go into heaven." Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem. And they went up to the upper room where they were staying, Peter and John, James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus and Simon the Zealot, and Judas the son of James. All these with one accord were devoting themselves to prayer, together with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers. Now in those days, Peter stood up among the brothers and said, "Brothers, the scripture had to be fulfilled which the Holy Spirit spoke beforehand through the mouth of our father David concerning Judas, who became a guide to those who arrested Jesus. For he was numbered among us and was allotted his share in this ministry. Now this man bought a field with the reward of his wickedness, and falling headlong, he burst open in the middle and all his bowels gushed out. And this became known to all the inhabitants of Jerusalem, so that the field was called in their own language Akeldama, that is, field of blood. For it is written in the Psalms, 'May his camp become desolate, and let there be no one to dwell in it, and let another take his office.' So, one of the men who have accompanied us, during all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day when he was taken up from us, one of these men must become with us a witness to his resurrection." And they put forward two, Joseph called Barsabas and Matthias. And they prayed and said, "You, Lord, who know the hearts of all, show which of these two you have chosen to take the place in this ministry and apostleship from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place." And they cast lots for them. And the lot fell on Matthias, and he was numbered with the 11 apostles. Now, when the day of Pentecost arrived, They were all together in one place, and suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting, and divided tongues as of fire appeared to them and rested on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven, and at this sound the multitude came together. And they were amazed and bewildered, saying, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us in his own native language, Parthians and Medes and Elamites and residents from Mesopotamia, Cappadocia and Asia, Pontus and Persia, Egypt and Pamphylia? We hear them telling in our own tongues the mighty works of God." And all were amazed and perplexed, saying, "How can this be?" But others, mocking, said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter lifted up his voice and addressed them, saying, "Men of Jerusalem, and all who dwell in Judea, give ear to my words. For these men are not drunk as you suppose, since it is only 9 in the morning. But this is what was uttered through the prophet Joel. And in the last days it shall be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. And your young men shall see visions. And your old men shall dream dreams. Even on my male and female servants in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show signs in the heavens above and wonders on the earth below, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood, before the day of the Lord comes, the great and magnificent day. And it shall come to pass that everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with mighty signs and wonders that God did through him in your midst, this Jesus delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men. But God raised him up, loosing the pains of death, for it was not possible for him to be held by it. For David says concerning him, 'I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand that I might not be shaken. Therefore my heart was glad and my tongue rejoiced. My flesh also will dwell in hope. For you will not abandon my soul to Hades, nor will you allow your Holy One to see corruption. You have made known to me the path of life. You will make me full of gladness in your presence.' Brothers, I may say to you with confidence about the patriarch David that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. See, being therefore a prophet, he foresaw and spoke about the resurrection of the Christ, that he was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh see corruption. See, this Jesus God raised up, and of that we all are witnesses. See, having therefore been exalted at the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the gift of the Holy Spirit, he has poured out this that you yourselves are seeing and hearing. Let all the house of Israel therefore know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified." Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart, and they said to Peter and the rest of the disciples, "Brothers, what shall we do?" And Peter said to them, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and for your children and for all who are far off, for everyone whom the Lord our God calls to himself." And with many other words, he bore witness and continued to exhort them, saying, "Save yourselves from this crooked generation." So those who received his words were baptized. And there were added that day about 3,000 souls. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and prayers. And awe came upon every soul. And many signs and wonders would be done among the people by the hands of the apostles. And they were all together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to each as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number, day by day, those who were being saved. Now, Peter and John were going up to the temple at the hour of prayer. And a man who was crippled from birth was being carried to be set at the temple gate to ask alms of those about to enter the temple. Well, seeing Peter and John about to enter the temple, he asked to receive alms. And Peter directed his gaze at him, as did John. And he said to him, look at us. And he fixed his attention on them, expecting to receive something from them. But Peter said to them, I have no silver or gold, but what I do have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And he took him by the right hand and raised him up. And immediately his feet and ankles became strong. And leaping up, he stood and began to walk. And he entered the temple with them, walking and leaping and praising God. Now, when all the people saw him walking and praising God and recognized him as the one that sat at the beautiful gate of the temple, asked to receive alms, they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. While he clung to Peter and John, all the people ran together to them in Solomon's portico. Now, when Peter saw it, he addressed them, men of Israel, why do you wonder at this? Or why do you stare at us as though by our own power or piety we have made him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, the God of our fathers has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you delivered up and denied in the presence of Pilate when he had decided to release him. But you denied the holy and righteous one, and you asked that a murderer be granted to you. And you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. And his name, by faith in his name, has given this man this perfect health in the presence of you all. Now I know you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. But what God foretold through the mouth of his holy prophets long ago, he thus fulfilled. Repent, therefore, and turn again, that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send the Christ appointed for you, Jesus, whom heaven must receive until the time for restoring all the things spoken about by the prophets long ago. Moses said, the Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your brothers. And it shall be that every soul who does not listen to that prophet shall be destroyed from among the people. And all the prophets who have spoken, from Samuel and those who came after him, all have proclaimed these days. See, you are the sons of the prophets and of the covenant that God swore with an oath to our father Abraham, saying, and in your offspring shall all the nations be blessed. See, God, having raised up his servant, sent him to you first to bless you by turning every one of you from your wickedness. And as they were speaking to the people, the priest and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees came upon them, greatly annoyed because they were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection from the dead. So they put them in the prison till the next day, for it was already evening. Still, many of those who heard the word believed, and the number of men grew to about 5,000. Now, the next day, their rulers and elders gathered together in Jerusalem with John and Caiaphas and Alexander and all who were of the high priestly family. And when they had set them in the midst, they inquired, by what power, by what name did you do this? Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers of the people and elders, if we are being examined today concerning a good deed done to a crippled man, by what means this man has been healed, then let it be known to all of you and to all the inhabitants of Jerusalem that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you killed by hanging him on a tree, by him this man is standing before you well. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else, for there was no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. Now, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and realized that they were common, uneducated men, they were astonished. And they recognized that they had been with Jesus. But seeing the man who was healed standing next to them, they had nothing to say in opposition. Finally, when they had commanded them to leave the council, they conferred with one another. What shall we do with these men? For that a notable sign has been performed through them is evident to all the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and we cannot deny it. But in order that it may spread no further among the people, let us warn them to speak no more to anyone in this name. So they called them and charged them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John said to them, whether it is right in the sight of God to obey you rather than God, you must judge. For we cannot but speak of what we have seen and heard. And when they had further threatened them, they let them go, finding no way to punish them because of the people. For all were praising God for what had happened. For the man on whom this miraculous sign of healing had been performed was more than 40 years old. Then they left the chief priest and the elders, and they told their friends what the council had said to them. When they heard it, they lifted their voices together to God and said, Sovereign Lord, who made the heavens, the earth, the sea, and everything in them, who said through the mouth of our father David, your servant, by the Holy Spirit, why did the Gentiles rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his anointed. For truly in this place there were gathered together against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, to do whatever your hand and your plan had predestined to take place. And now, Father, look upon their threats and grant your servants to continue to speak your word with all boldness while you stretch out your hand to heal and signs and wonders are performed through the name of your holy servant, Jesus. And when they had prayed, the place in which they were gathered together was shaken and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and continued to speak the word with boldness. Now the full number of those who believed were of one heart and soul. And no one said that any of the things that belonged to him was his own, but they had everything in common. And with great power, the apostles were continuing to give their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as were owners of lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold and laid it at the apostles' feet. And it was distributed to each as any had need. Thus Joseph, who was also called by the apostles Barnabas, which means son of encouragement, sold a field that belonged to him and brought the proceeds and laid it at the apostles' feet. But a man named Ananias, together with his wife Sapphira, sold a piece of property, and he kept back for himself part of the proceeds and brought only some of it and laid it at the apostles' feet. But Peter said to him, Ananias, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit and to keep back for yourself part of the proceeds of the land? While it remained unsold, was it not your own? And after it was sold, was it not at your disposal? How is it that you've contrived this deed in your heart? You have not lied to men, but to God. Now when Ananias heard these words, he fell down and breathed his last. And great fear came upon all who heard of it. The young men rose, wrapped him up, carried him out, and buried him. Now, after an interval of about 3 hours, his wife came in, not knowing what had happened. And Peter said to her, tell me, is this the price that you and Ananias got for the land? She answered, yes, that is the price. And he said to her, how is it that you've conspired together to test the Spirit of the Lord? Behold, the feet of the men who have buried your husband are at the door, and they will carry you out." Immediately she fell at his feet and breathed her last. When the young men came in, they found her dead, and they carried her out and buried her beside her husband. And great fear came upon the whole church and upon all who heard of these things. Now, in those days, when the disciples were increasing in number, a complaint by the Hellenists arose against the Hebrews because their widows were being neglected in the daily distribution. And so the 12 summoned the full number of the disciples and said, "It is not right that we should give up preaching the word of God to serve tables. Therefore, brothers, pick out from among you 7 men of good repute, whom we will appoint to this duty. But we will devote ourselves to prayer and to the ministry of the word." And what they said pleased the whole gathering. So they chose Stephen, a man full of grace and of the Holy Spirit, and Philip, and Prochorus, and Nicanor, and Timon, and Parmenas, and Nicholas, a proselyte of Antioch. These they set before the disciples, the apostles, and they prayed and laid their hands on them. And the word of God continued to increase. And the number of disciples increased greatly in Jerusalem, and a great number of the priests became obedient to the faith. And Stephen, full of grace and power, was doing great signs and wonders among the people. But then some of those who belonged to the synagogue of the freedmen arose, and of those from Cilicia and Asia, and disputed with Stephen, but they could not withstand the wisdom and the power with which he spoke. So then they secretly instigated men who said, "We have heard him speak blasphemous words against Moses and the law." And they stirred up the scribes and the elders and the council, and they came upon him and set him before the council. And they set up false witnesses who said, "We have heard him say that this Jesus of Nazareth will destroy this place and will change the customs that Moses delivered to us." And all who sat in the council saw that his face was like the face of an angel. And the high priest said to him, "Are these things so?" And Stephen said to him, "Brothers and fathers, hear me. The God of glory appeared to our father Abraham when he was in Mesopotamia before he lived in Haran and said to him, 'Go out from your land and from your kindred into the land that I will show you.' So he went out from there and lived in Haran. And after his father died, God removed him from there into this land in which you are now living, even though he had no foot's length in it, and he only had the promise of the covenant of circumcision. And so Abraham became the father of Isaac, Isaac the father of Jacob, Jacob the father of the 12 patriarchs. Now the patriarchs, jealous of Joseph, sold him into Egypt. But God was with him and rescued him out of all his afflictions and gave him favor and wisdom before Pharaoh, king of Egypt, who made him ruler over all Egypt and over all his household. But as the time of the promise grew near, our forefathers multiplied in Egypt until there arose over Egypt a new king who did not know about Joseph. He dealt shrewdly with our race, and he forced our fathers to expose their infants that they would not be kept alive. Now at this time Moses was born, and he was beautiful in God's sight. And after 3 months he was exposed, and Pharaoh's daughter took him and raised him up as her own child. Now when he was 40 years old, it came into his heart to visit his brothers, the children of Israel. And seeing one of them being wronged, he defended the oppressed man by striking down the Egyptian. He supposed that his brothers would realize that God was giving them salvation by his hand. But they did not understand. And on the following day, he appeared to them as they were quarreling and said, 'Men, you are brothers. Why do you wrong each other?' But the man who was wronging his brother thrust him aside, saying, 'Who made you a ruler and a judge over us? Are you thinking of killing me the way you killed the Egyptian yesterday?' Well, at this retort, Moses fled. And he became an exile in the land of Midian, where he became the father of 2 sons. Now when 40 years had passed, the angel of God appeared to him on Mount Sinai in flames of fire from within a burning bush. He said to him, 'I have surely seen the misery of my people in Egypt, and I have come down to rescue them. So now go, I am sending you to Egypt.' This Moses, whom they rejected, this man led them out of Egypt performing signs and wonders in Egypt and at the Red Sea and in the wilderness for 40 years. This is the Moses who said to the people, "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your brothers, and it shall be that every soul who does not listen to that prophet shall be destroyed from among the people." You stiff-necked people, uncircumcised in heart and ears, you always resist the Holy Spirit. Which of the prophets did not your fathers persecute? And they killed those who announced the coming of the righteous one, whom you have now betrayed and murdered. You who received the laws delivered by angels but did not keep it. Now when they heard this, they were enraged and they gnashed their teeth at him. But he, full of the Holy Spirit, gazed into heaven and saw Jesus standing at the right hand of God. And he said, "Behold, I see the heavens standing open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." But they stopped their ears, rushed together at him, seized him, dragged him out of the city, and stoned him. And the witnesses laid down their garments at the feet of a young man named Saul. And as they were stoning Stephen, he cried out, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." And falling to his knees, he cried with a loud voice, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them." And when he had said this, he fell asleep. And Saul approved of his execution. And there arose on that day a great persecution against the church in Jerusalem, and they were all scattered throughout the region of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. Saul was entering house after house and carrying off men and women and putting them into prison. Then, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, he went to the chief priest, and he asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any there belonging to the way, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. So as he went on his way, he approached Damascus, and suddenly a light from heaven flashed all around him, and falling to his knees, he heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" And he said, Who are you, Lord?" And he said, "I am Jesus whom you are persecuting. But rise and go into the city, and you will be told what you are to do." Now the men traveling with him stood speechless, hearing the voice, but seeing no one. So Saul rose from the ground, and although his eyes were open, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand and brought him safely into Damascus. And for 3 days he was without sight and neither ate nor drank. Now, there was a disciple in Damascus named Ananias. The Lord appeared to him in a vision and said, "Ananias." "Here I am, Lord," he answered. And the Lord said, "Rise and go to the street called Straight. Enter the house of Judas. Look for a man of Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. And he has seen in a vision a man named Ananias come in and lay his hands on him so that he might regain his sight." But Ananias answered, "But Lord, I've heard from many about this man, how much evil he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And here he has authority from the chief priest to bind all who call on your name." But the Lord said to him, "Go, for he is a chosen instrument of mine to carry my name before the Gentiles and kings and the peoples of Israel. For I will show him how much he must suffer for the sake of my name." So Ananias departed, and entering the house, he laid his hands on him. "Brother Saul," he said, "the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road by which you came, has sent me so that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." And immediately something like scales fell from his eyes, and he regained his sight. Then he rose and was baptized, and taking food and water, he was strengthened. And for many days he was with the disciples in Damascus. And immediately he began proclaiming Jesus in the synagogues, saying, "He is the Christ." Now all who heard him were amazed and said, "Is this not he who wreaked havoc of those in Jerusalem who call upon this name And has he not come here for this purpose, to bring them bound to Jerusalem? But Saul increased all the more in strength and confounded the Jews who lived in Damascus by proving that Jesus was the Christ. After many days, the Jews plotted to kill him, but their plot became known to Saul. They were watching the gates day and night in order to kill him, but his disciples took him by night and lowered him down in a basket through an opening in the wall. Now, when he had come to Jerusalem, he attempted to join the disciples, but they were all afraid of him because they did not believe that he was a disciple. So finally, Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles and told them how on the road he had seen the Lord who had spoken to him. Now, he had spoken boldly in the name of Jesus in Damascus. So he, Saul, or Paul, went in and out among them in Jerusalem. And so the church throughout all Judea and Samaria and Galilee had peace and was being built up and walking in the fear of the Lord and in the comfort of the Holy Spirit. It multiplied. That's what we're supposed to look like. Pretty high bar, huh? Did you notice that in all of that sharing and love and oneness of heart, the fearlessness the Holy Spirit gave Peter, Paul, to share this message that would surely get them condemned to death? Think about the persecution that early church experienced. They were being thrown to the lions, crucified upside down. I think that's something we're a little more in touch with now. I know I've been sharing scripture for about 20 years, and the last 4 or 5 years I've been telling everybody our window for being able to do this freely is closing, and now I think people actually believe me when I say that. We had about 70% of our schedule canceled because of COVID, so we weren't able to reach as many people and encourage as many saints, but more than that, we weren't able to get kids helped. Our whole ministry is called Acts of the Word. We exist to inspire believers to actually act out what God's Word says. We encourage them to be generous like that first century church. We partner with Food for the Hungry. They're an amazing Christian relief organization. They're missionaries, and they go into the poorest places on the planet with a goal of transforming villages and discipling children, discipling the next generation of the church. They're making themselves sufficient. They do an incredible job, but we normally get thousands of kids helped every year, and we weren't able to do that in 2020 nearly as much. We've just started kind of back in a full schedule in April, this past April, but I really missed, as we were going through the changes as a ministry, I was calling different churches and hearing all of the stories of change all across the country. I was most mindful of the people who have the least, which are usually not in this country. These people in third world countries, the Dominican Republic, I've been there. It's right, Haiti and the Dominican Republic are on the same island that just got slammed by the earthquake and then the storm on top of that. They're the ones who really need help more than any of us. I can't encourage you enough, do something with this encouragement. Seize the day to serve the Lord. We are in a window that is closing. We can expect persecution to come our way. We have the opportunity to continue to sow. Every time I go, I've been overseas 5 times now to visit kids we've sponsored personally. And every time I go, I'm blown away. They always have all the letters I've ever written them. And the last time I was able to go, I went to Guatemala, little Lucas, 10-year-old. I was sending him verses to memorize. And of course, first thing he says to me is he starts quoting all my verses. Had 30-some verses memorized. And his mom was just looking there smiling like she's heard them a million times. And I thought, isn't that great? She's heard this a lot. His family's heard this a lot. His friends have heard this a lot. I have actually discipled someone to share the gospel. Pretty cool. But just a reminder of how great the soil is. When you're transforming somebody's whole village, their life, their education, their health, their finances, they're listening to you. You have their ear. You have a great opportunity to share who God is because they know it's a miracle of God that you're helping them. If you want to sponsor a child, I have picture folders there on my table. It's just $38 a month. You can do it for as long or as short as you like. Some of us can afford to do more than one child. I can't encourage that enough. They're very needy. So thank you so much. Pick one of those picture folders up. There's a little perforated form there. Fill it out. Open it up. Fill it out. Tear the form off. Put it in an envelope, the envelope that's inside. Hand it to whoever's at the table, and then take the picture home. Be about 2 weeks before you can start corresponding back and forth with your child. And many of the kids we have, I think 3 out of 5, we can email them. So it's great. We're praying about and thinking about them. But we want to share the grace God's given us, this good news. We want to share that. And we have the opportunity, and there are people who will listen, despite how dark the world around us is growing. And so that's where we need to be sowing seed. So thank you so much. There are a few End Times books that I have left at the table. Great stuff. This is a great time to be digging into that part of God's word, because things are coming and you need to know what God's game plan is. And if you haven't studied in a while, you need to keep looking, because it gets clearer when we get closer, as we get closer. I know how much I've learned just in the last 4 or 5 years that has blown me away. There's so much detail about what God is about to do, and he wants you, his servants, to know that and to be able to hold fast to that and have the hope that is in Jesus. So let's put all of our chips there. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the grace you've given us through your Son, this precious gift of eternal life. Help us to be a good steward of it. Help us to share it regardless of how dark it gets around us. Open our hearts and our minds to those who might be willing to hear your word, to heed your word, Lord. Let us continue to sow the knowledge of who you are into this world. And we know, we trust, you are going to produce fruit from your word. I just pray that all the mercy you've given us flows right through us to others, Lord. Allow that to happen, because it's all about your Son, his kingdom, and his glory. Amen. Amen.
Thank you so much, Marquis. I said if you knew, you knew, and now if you didn't know, you know. What a blessing it is every time Marquis is able to visit us. Please do check out his resources as you exit today, and also let us know if you'd like to get involved in small groups. We've got some tents of people out there to greet you. Go in peace, go in assurance of the love of Christ today. We hope to see you back next week.